Hey everyone, my name is Carlos Chavez, and a little while ago, I visited the El Paso Museum of Art. The El Paso Museum of Art is located in downtown El Paso, Texas. The museum was founded in 1959, but it wasn't until 1998 until the museum moved to its current residence in downtown El Paso. The museum is widely known for its crest collection, which features 12th to 18th century European art. The museum has also collected a wide range of southwestern United States art, as well as art from northern Mexico. This is relevant because the El Paso Museum of Art is located in the borderland. When you think of naturalistic sculpture, you usually think back to ancient Greece and how they paid very close attention to anatomy. I chose this sculpture because the artist depicted the cowboy and his horse in a proportional manner. The size of both figures are always true to life. The movement of the horse rearing and the cowboy holding out his hat really shows that the artist pays a lot of attention to detail. The proportion of all the body parts and everything are very true to form. From there, I made my way to the crest collection, where many of the European artworks are displayed. My favorite was by Sano di Pietro, titled Madonna and Child with St. John the Baptist, St. Bartholomew, and Angels, dated around the 1460s to the 1470s. This painting, made of tempera and gold on the wood panel, was produced in Siena and commemorates Mary as the Heavenly Queen and Mother. Delicately inscribed in her halo is the Archangel Gabriel's greeting, a detail that would have reminded the faithful to recite their prayers. Most of the figures of this painting have a relaxed expression, and this brought about a feeling of calmness to me. Next, we bring our attention to the Madonnas painted by Prevotelli and Botticelli. The painting by Ilmado Sandro Botticelli from Italy is titled Madonna and Child, and most likely comes from the 1490s. This Madonna was produced in his workshop and is considered one of the greatest artists in Renaissance Italy. Its circular shape, called a tonnotto, indicates that the painting originally hung in a private home. Especially in Botticelli's painting, the Madonna and her son meet cheek to cheek. This is called the Virgin of the Sweet Kiss. The painting by Andrea Prevotelli, also from Italy, is dated about 1512 to 1515, and is also titled Madonna and Child. Both of these paintings feature a hooded Madonna. Both are holding the child, and both of the frames are very ornate. The dominant feature of this painting is that both of the children are looking at the Virgin. Some differences in these paintings is that in Prevotelli's Madonna, the halo is muted, while in Botticelli's, the halo is very prominent. In Botticelli's Madonna, both of the figures are depicted sitting on a throne, while in Prevotelli's, they are seated upon an open window. And finally, Botticelli's artwork was most likely private, while the ownership of Prevotelli's artwork is unknown. As we continued through the crest collection, I couldn't help but notice all of the female portraits that are hanging in the museum. A girl in a red dress and a girl in a blue dress have their gazes looking towards the viewer, but they have their gaze shifted to the side. Young woman with a parrot, an allegory of winter, both have their breasts exposed, but in the way that the museum has them set up, are looking away from each other, almost as if they don't want to see each other's breasts. In the American collection of the museum, we see a portrait of Margaret H. Sanford, who has her gaze set straight toward the viewer, but has her hand resting on her chin. One of the portraits of women that I enjoyed the most was titled Girl at a Window. This painting by Rembrandt came from a multi-generational family of painters who contributed much to the development of American art during a period of revolution and nation building. Rembrandt excelled in portraits of family and friends, and the present work has been called a portrait of his daughter Rosabla. Most likely, it is an example of his fanciful and idealized pictures of women and children, since Rosabla was in her mid-40s at the time. The painting emulates a famous work by the artist namesake, the 17th century master Rembrandt, compared to the earthy naturalism and subtle lighting of the elder artist painting, Peale's picture adds a note of red and utilizes more finish and idealization, for example, in the smooth porcelain skin and precisely rendered curls. This large painting, titled Our Lady of Carmel, comes from Lorenzo Romero during the 18th century Spanish colonial period of Mexico. After I explored the crest and Mexican art collections, I moved on to the retablo collection. This collection features many scale paintings. From here, I tried to find the smallest scale painting. This painting by Mabel May Woodward is titled Coastal Scene and is oil on canvas board. The date of this painting is unknown, but it was gifted to the Paso Museum of Art in the 1970s. This next painting by Manuel Acosta, an American born in Mexico, is titled Desert Legend from 1978. The oil on masonite painting signals a symbolic intent. Together, the cow's skull, dried sea pods, and desert plants create a homage to the artist's environment, and the grasses with shoots of flowers suggest continuity. Moving on from the retablo collection, we can make our way to the American Art Gallery, which features the 19th century salon. The 19th century salon contains a collection of 18 paintings. These paintings are an installation of figural works and contain all different types of paintings, whether that be in private mansions or public museums. Notably, the figural works were focused on women, which is not surprising in this period when most artists were white males and the female body was a favorite subject in decorative, symbolic, or domestic scenes. The painting depicts a fallen tree in a forest of barren trees. The diagonal implied line shows the dramatic nature of the trees and emphasizes the death that this forest has experienced, and uses multiple hues of blue to show the movement of the water and elicits an excited or energetic emotion from the viewer. The high white and blue values show the animation of the water as it crashes into the low key rocks, which are painted using brown values. The balancing of both keys shows the energetic and dramatic aspects of this piece of art. Landscape by George Innes shows emphatic focal point and chiaroscuro. This painting, dated 1842 or 1847, features oil on canvas and draws your eyes to the figure sitting in the well-lit clearing beside the road. The deliberate use of brighter or higher value colors draws the viewers to this clearing, showing that the sun is poking through the clouds during the time of day that this is painted in. Implied motion is shown in Gladys in Chinese Robes by Irving Ramsey Watt. This American painting, dated 1920 to 1929, from oil and canvas, shows a woman that could easily be fanning herself. Central Park East by John E. Costigan shows actual texture. The oil on canvas and the way the artist layers the pigments shows the coarse, almost scratchy surface, which makes you want to go up and touch it. Interior of the Corcoran Gallery in Washington, D.C. by Edmund Charles Tarbell shows diminishing size. The figure in the foreground of the painting contrasts with the figure in the background, which shows the size of the space in which these two are displayed in. The perspective forces the eyes to travel from the front to the back. Moving on from the 19th century salon, we go into the Hunt Family Gallery. The El Paso Museum of Art is holding an exhibition by Andrea Bowers. Andrea Bowers is known for her powerful yet playful works of art in a variety of media, drawing, video, sculptures, and even installation, which advocate for justice by highlighting those who fight for racial, gender, environmental, labor, and even immigration justice, and those affected by systemic inequality. The installation in the museum offers an entrio of colored light signs, united by squares of color painted nearly floor to ceiling. The light and cardboard pieces, two of which were created for the exhibition, highlight slogans from recent protests against enforcement of immigration policies along the United States-Mexico border. The phrases, "families belong together," "sanctuary," and "abolish ICE," appear not hand-drawn wielded on place cards, but overhead in the sky, in bright lights, glowing colors, and joyful fonts that summon a positive spirit. I especially enjoyed this exhibition by Bowers because her art was interactive. It lit up, and you could go up and see the details of each of the cardboard. Most of the cardboard came from commercial boxes, and you can see even in the tiny details that her art comes from her personal life. Finally, as we exited the museum, I couldn't help but notice this giant, non-objective sculpture. This sculpture by James Searles, an American born in 1943, titled "Me, Knife, Diamond, and Flower, Yo, Cuchillo, Diamante, y Flor," from 1999, is made of pine, poplar, and steel. Placed in the lobby, this artwork takes up much of the space. As you can see, the knife and the flower are made of wood, while the diamond and the artist's self-portrait are made of metal. As we exit the museum, we find the sculpture titled "Identidad Geométrica" by Oswaldo Sagastegui, a Mexican who was born in Peru. This sculpture from 2012 is made of steel and polyurethane. The sign explicitly says not to climb the sculpture, but it's really hard because the sharp lines make it easily climbable. The sculpture is mainly made of two colors, red and green. Two triangles meet together to create this towering sculpture. The stature and size of the sculpture show how commanding it is in the entranceway to the Museum of Art. My tour around the Paso Museum of Art was wonderful, and I hope you all enjoyed this video. Thanks for watching!